We're going to have a very strong focus, we'll say, on the whole question of young people coming into farming and is there a future? And the sort of skills that are necessary for anybody who's, looking at to have a successful, happy farming career. And then we're going to develop it a bit in terms of younger people getting started, chair milking and various others, and moving along the ladder. So today we'll say they're delighted to talk to Kevin and Margaret Twomey. Kevin and Margaret will say that from a relatively small base have built a really strong, solid, excellent dairy business and are noted, we'll say, for being very, very good, we'll say, that in terms of younger people who come into their employ, we'll say that in terms of giving them every chance to develop skills and some of these people are doing extremely well. But also Kevin is very involved in putting together training courses for farmers at different levels. So Kevin, could I toss the question to you and to Margaret. Are you happy that this quotas, the long awaited about quotas lifted this year, but given what's happened to price, are you both happy that there is a good future within farming for young people?
Yeah, I suppose. Are we happy that quotas have gone and there's a bit more freedom to farm, for want of a better word? Yes, we'd be very happy. We've always thought there's a great future in dairy farming. We're strong advocates that you farm for profit but for fun as well, and it must be an enjoyable lifestyle. And part of that, I suppose, is understanding, what your core business is and how what's important to make your business happen and to be very successful at it, you must know your cost base. So really, the price is up and down, essentially over time, yes, it does really matter, but what really matters actually is the margin between the price and the cost of production. So that's essentially the farming margin that's most important of all. So we probably set up our farming system so that we can farm through the lean times relatively comfortably and in the better times that it can be really rewarding.
Sure. Margaret would say, how many in the family are any of them looking as if they might go to the farming
industry? Well, we've four children. Emma's 14 and Owen is 12 and Neva's 9 and Dara is 7. The eldest girl will do farm work, but I don't think she'll go down the path of farming. Owen is 12 and he's very interested in farming and very good at stock. Neve is 9 and she actually loves farming as well and very interested in going out helping and asking questions. And Dara then is 7 and he loves the farming as well. And we try and get them involved in, especially the weekends, to go out and help on the farm, do a bit of milking. When we're calving cows, they come out and they feed the calves. Also, when I'm registering all the calves, I actually show them how to register the calves and sit down with them as well and explain to them,
clearly the decision as to whether they go farming or not, that must be theirs.
Absolutely, you can't make them go farming, it has to be their own decision, You can't force anyone. So we're giving our best guidance we can and the encouragement and showing them the right way it's to be done, but we're not always right too, And we hope down the road that if one of them did decide to go farming that they will go.
And given the enjoyment that both of you get from farming, there's a good chance perhaps that one or two of them may follow the same route.
Oh, definitely, yeah. They see it's a good life, you work hard, but you've also a great life, you take your holidays, you take your break, And also it's good to see, we're both at home, we're both involved in the business, in the quiet period, in the evening, Kevin is in and we're all here for the evening, and Kevin's not on the road every day or away, so they have plenty of time with their mum and dad, which is great.
Yeah. Kevin will say that, if I look back, will say that 46 odd years ago, I decided to go farming, went off to my college, and the changes in farming since then have been huge. We hadn't heard the single farm payments, nitrates, we were hardly regulated, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The guaranteed prices, etc. There's been huge change. And almost certainly there will be a huge change over the next 20, 30, 40 years.
Absolutely.
What in your view will say sort of the skills necessary, will say that, you know, in terms of your, for a young person entering farming, how would you, what do you think they need to absolutely learn, and how do you think what's the best approach to actually acquire those skills?
Okay, I suppose there's always been changes in farming, and there always will be changes in farming, so it's never going to be a set pace or set of anything. The rules will change and circumstances change. So the one thing we can do is prepare ourselves for change, and the best way to prepare ourselves for change is to educate ourselves, you know, and be aware that things will change. So I'm a firm belief that education is the best way, and it's a continual life learning education. It's not that you finish ag college and you know it all, that doesn't happen. So even after agricultural college, you have to continue to learn off others or learn through courses. And so there are many different ways. So I suppose for young people today, if they decide that farming, dairy farming for them is the career that they're going to choose, then look, there's a number of paths you can go. I suppose the more obvious one or the more normal path would be agricultural college. It's a 2-year course now to a level 6 degree and finishing, and many go home at that stage, which is unfortunately probably a big mistake, I think, for most, because they're home too soon in their farming career. They have a lot more to see and learn. And for me, the next 2 or 3 years after that are probably the more vital years, where you broaden your life skills. So my view is, there's a course there now, Professional Dairy Farm Manager's course, is a very good 2-year on-farm placement. It replaced the original Farm Apprenticeship Board course that had finished 10 years prior. And that's very useful because you're out on farm, you're learning off others, you're actually learning life skills because you're living maybe away from home, and you have to interact with a new community, new sports or whatever clubs that might be in the area. And these are skills that are maybe even outside of farming that are very important to develop. But also you develop a team of camaraderie of people, a network of people that you can use and develop together, and I think that's really important that you can do that. So that's one path. Another path, and many parents, I believe, have, I suppose, it's the norm maybe now to go to university, which is hugely different from many years ago, and that's very good and excellent as well. But probably one of the aspects lacking in that, particularly in some of the agricultural degrees within universities or the ITs, is the practical element of doing courses. It really is very weak. In real terms of being really practical, it's very weak, and I think there's a lot of work to be done on that, and hopefully there will be a review of the courses in time that will help to build that, because it's well and good having the theoretical, but actually the practical, being able to implement them learnings and practically see how you use them is vital if you're going to have a career in dairy farming. And the last path, I suppose, and this comes to all others, might be people who go to, even mightn't do an agricultural degree at all, might do something totally different and do a bit of travel around the world, and that can be equally as good, because you're broadening yourself, you come back into farming then with maybe a fresh look. But I still think it's vital for that person when coming back into farming to go and learn their skills somewhere else before they go to the home farm, for that last year or 2 or 3 before they come back to a home farm situation, is to develop their, build on the life skills and education they got on other skills, and develop that on other farms. And for me, that's a really successful path as well, for the very dedicated few that will go that way. Not many will go that way, but it can be really successful as well.
You talked of you know, education has been a continuing process. Would say that
yes,
irrespective of which of the three pathways
yeah,
you take. Would you outline some of the particular routes that you, some of the particular things you've done in terms of continuing education that you might recommend to young people?
Yes. I suppose the continuous education is huge, really, because all circumstances around us are changing. The resources that we have available to us on the farm, or the input from other people, and that all changes all the time. So look, discussion groups is probably a very prominent and should be a very prominent part of every dairy farmer's life, because that gives you peer-to-peer learning, it gives you community learning effect as well also. So that's very easy and can be facilitated quite well then, so it can be a benefit to everyone. So you can upskill yourself then by doing some financial courses, and some are given by Chagas and some by private companies or educators in third level. And there's a range of them, and hopefully we'll develop even a further suite of upskilling courses, like a milking course, proper fencing courses and stuff like that. That kind of has been forgotten about. Some of the basic skills that kind of got forgotten about through the Celtic Tiger era, and they're actually not really taught anywhere else, and needs a lot of hands-on time. So they will be developed over time. I think there's no doubt about that. So there's many opportunities for upskilling around, and I think it's up to that young person's, you know, to go and seek that. Really is backing yourself. Do you want to continually learn? And it can be very built into your way of life, you know, and it's seen as being part of your network and everyday learning without you even knowing you're doing it.
Yeah. Margaret will say that, sometimes will say that, there's a view will say that a lot of further training of farmers is geared at the man, will say, rather than the couple. Would you sort of have any views on that?
Well, I think that I think women are as capable as men, really, you know, and I think people underestimate women in farming and think they're not able to do farming. I mean, I came from a tillage background. I never milked a cow until I met Kevin, and I mean, I can milk the 300 cows on my own now. So you know, I just think women are as able, you know, and every aspect with management, with people, staff, you know.
It probably comes back, if you know, to a bit of support, you know, and you know, it's support around you could call it women in agriculture, but it's that. It's women are part and parcel of farming, and always have been, but they never really got the recognition, you know, and that's quite true of my own family, my own mother, you know, and I think that's across the country. So I think it's just a recognition that yes. Women and men can do this alike and really can make it successful.
And would you share the view, we'll say that when the couple, both are on the same wavelength, sharing the same goals, we'll say jointly contributing to things, it's not just 1 + 1 = 2, it's more like 1 + 1 = 4.
Oh yeah, definitely, yeah. Definitely, yeah. Yeah. When you work together, like you definitely, your business, yeah. You know, you have a better understanding of the business, and you know, you share your views and you bounce ideas off each other, you know, and I think, you know, if it's your business, you're going to look after it, you know.
I suppose we made the conscious decision that Margaret would finish up working in her job and come back and make this farm a family farm, but make it a two-person farm. So we knew we had to grow the business a bit to justify us both being at home full-time. And like for us, the rewards of doing that are really, really massive, because you know, we can plan our own time off, we can organize ourselves, we're answerable to ourselves, which is good, so we can basically, you know, we're self-employed people and it's up to us how we want to live our lives, and we can, like, we both make dim choices, you know, together now, and that's been great since Margaret's come back, and she understands the business probably better than me in some parts, and we have our roles within the business, which is probably very important that we both know which aspects of the business we're doing and who's doing what and how we can coordinate that to work together, you know.
And when husband and wife would say really working together as a team, it probably offers a fantastic quality of family life.
Oh, absolutely, yes. You know, you're both at home, you're both fully involved in the business, you know, but you're still here for your kids, you know. I mean, so
yeah, I think hopefully our kids can see a bit of work ethic, I think, which is, for us, look, we're parents like millions of other parents in the world. We're not any different. We don't have all the answers. We make the mistakes that everyone makes, and all we can do is try and show our children look, a farm life is a good way of life. It's there for you, you know. It's not there for you if you want it, because you have to really want it. And I suppose, you know, for them to just see that and grow an interest in the business, I think is really good. And grow an understanding of farming is really good, because it gives you a very broad picture of life anyway. And I think that's really important. And really, it's up to the children in their own time to see whether farming is for them or for not. But we can't make the choice for them. All we can do is show them the reality of the situation. Look, it's a good life if you work hard and can put the business together and operate and understand how the business works, really. It can be a good life, but you must understand the business. And all we can do is just show them, and it's up to them in their own time.
It's pretty important for young people that they actually make the choice they want to go into it themselves. And pretty important, I think, actually, that they decide themselves that they want to be really good farmers. Yeah. And if you're that basis, we'll say that anything is possible.
Yeah, I think anything is possible. And it's like any, I suppose, job in life. If you're finding it working hard, then, you know, that really is a job. Whereas, I suppose, we don't really consider this as a job. This is a lifestyle,
for
us. And it's a different view, I think. And it's a very conscious decision about how we've structured that to happen, you know, and how we probably structured it, you know, for us to have at different times in our life. We would see this now as being an important decade to be available for the children, because after this decade passes, look, they'll be gone to college and gone, maybe, and we'll be back looking at ourselves again on our own, maybe, you know. And so we've decided to try and make time available now to be involved with the children in their sports and whatnot. So because we're self-employed and we can create that situation to happen, you know, we have a choice.
In fact, I mean, farming, it's probably hard to beat it in terms of the possibilities for family life.
I think it is, because the children are with us all the time, I suppose.
Yeah.
Well, so one thing that has to happen is, you know, there has to be a real strong bond between the parents, because like we're working together, we're living together, there's no getting away, you know, we are there, and when it's good, it really is good.
An old saying, like, lucky are those who love what they do. Because even though they work hard, they think they'll never work a day in their lives. Thanks very much.
That's true. You're welcome.